morning is Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
The tests. So they come up to test Christ, and they ask him a list of questions, and they're all tempting. And my favorite is the fact that Jesus doesn't answer any of the three questions in the same way. He doesn't say, "It is written. It is written. It is written." He does something completely different. At first, he takes a coin. I didn't have to borrow yours to me, so I found one that was kind of big. There you can see it against my white hand, it makes it glow. He takes a coin to answer this question. Instead of going to the scripture, he says he takes a coin and explains something deeper. Oy vey. Sorry, that was obvious. Shouldn't say oy vey in church. Oy vey. It's better than what some people say. Give me that one. The other one, he goes to a story in Exodus, and the story in Exodus is one of those that you sit there and you go, I didn't get that point. And it's the story of the burning bush, and he goes to the story of the burning bush. And they ask him about the resurrection. And he says, let me tell you about the resurrection. And he goes to this lovely verse that talks everything about the resurrection in Exodus. You ready? Then he said, do not come here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. Are you ready? He's going to say it all in one verse. He's going to describe the resurrection to you. You ready? And he said also, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Ooh, amen. So he described the resurrection. A little different because, well, most of us didn't look at that scripture and go, the resurrection. I found out the other day, in two weeks, it will not be Easter. I've been telling y'all for a month it's going to be Easter in 2 weeks, but somebody finally corrected me. I wonder if it would ever happen. But what I'd like you to do, I'd like you to go with me to Mark today. And keep in mind that they're coming at him because he's upset them. Remember, he's already cursed their beautiful religion and replaced it with some goofy church that, well, it's just a hodgepodge. He's already challenged them, and they're already saying, what authority do you have to speak to us that way? Why do you come to us with authority? Our scribes and teachers don't come that way. And challenging him. And so what they do is, after being upset, they come at him with questions. They're ready to stump him. So we're in Mark chapter 12, and they're going to come at Christ, and the whole point is to stump him. They're not asking these so they can be enlightened. They're asking it so they can stump Christ. We are in Matthew chapter 12, and we'll be starting in verse 13. And they sent to him some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him in his talk. And they came and said to him, Teacher, we know that you are true and do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances, but truly teach the way of God. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not? But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, why put me to the test? Bring me a denarius and let me look at it. And they brought one, and he said to them, whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And Jesus said to them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. Similar question we ask today is paying taxes. We should all hate it. That's an American duty. Whether you do it or not, you should hate it. Just so we can feel that camaraderie of hating something together. But it's something that most of us never look at. We never look at coins. But if you do it, they all are a little bit different. Some of them have human faces, and some of them have strange faces that may have been human at one time. But they all have four words. No matter what you pull out a bill, you pull out a coin. A bigger phrase. Yes, God, in God we trust is inscribed really, really tiny, so you get your magnifying glass and you're like, oh, they're religious. Okay. But in very big print, we always put these words. The United States of America. Of course, they don't use the. So you have four words. United States of America to remind us that that money belongs to who? Give to Caesar what is Caesar's? Money. Those coins that have very little value. That paper that has almost no value. And he answers them this. He says, give it to Caesar, it's Caesar's. Give those things to God, which are God's. And so instead of teaching them from the law or the prophets, he teaches them from a coin and says, think. But he continues in verse 18. And the Sadducees came to him, who say there's no resurrection. And they asked him a question, saying, teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife but leaves no child, the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brothers. There were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and when he died, left no offspring. And the second took her and died, leaving no offspring. And the third likewise. And the seventh left no offspring. Last of all, the woman also died. In the resurrection, when they rise again, whose wife will she be? For the seven had a rest wife. Jesus said to them, is this not the reason you are wrong, because you know neither the scripture nor the power of God? For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. And as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him, saying, I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. You are quite wrong. When they challenge him on the resurrection, he goes to a passage that if most of us read, we don't hear the resurrection. I don't know how many of us heard the resurrection and saying he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we look at God, and what does he do? He doesn't say, let me point you to the law. Again, what's he do? He says, let me point you to God. The very nature of God teaches us that there's a resurrection. So he doesn't take a coin this time, but he does take the very nature of God, and from the nature of God, he teaches. But once again, it's not as though he went to the law or the prophets and looked for a scripture. And he says this to who? The Sadducees. I want to tell you about something. We had that little song from Little Children's Church. I don't want to be a Sadducee because they're Sadducee. I'm like, that really doesn't teach us anything about them. They're just sad, okay? And that's most of what we know. And we know that the Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection. They must be people who don't believe in the Bible. That's the Pharisees. I hate to switch everything out on you. The Sadducees believe in the Bible. They don't believe in the resurrection because guess what word is not in the Old Testament? Resurrection. Okay. Guess what teaching is not quite that clear in the Old Testament? Resurrection. And so when we think of Sadducees, we have to go, what are the Sadducees? They're the bookworms. They are the guys who quote book, chapter, verse to you. They're the ones who can read off scripture and quote it off, and they need to have it memorized. And to become a Sadducee, you must have written down the Bible at some point. And they're the ones who will tell you exactly what the letter of the law says, and they will be right there with the Word. 100%. And yet he mentions this. He does. He says, you don't know the Scripture or the power of God. Because what have they done? They've taken the Word, they've removed it from God, and they've made it this thing to be worshipped. Sadducees worship the Word. They've been accused of it more than once. They worship the Bible. Somebody asked the other day, and I love this question, do you believe in the Bible? And they said the correct answer is no, I believe in Jesus. The Bible points to Jesus. That's what I believe in. The Bible points to God. That's what I believe in. That's where my faith rests, is in this almighty, powerful God. And that was kind of Jesus' point. I know you're reading this, but you're missing the God who wrote it. You're missing the God on Sinai who scribes that with his hand. You're missing out on the point. But they come to him again with the question most of us have heard. One of the scribes, verse 28, and one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that he answered them well, asked him, which commandment is the most important of all? Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And the scribe said to him, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and there is no other besides him. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength. And to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. He finally gets to the Bible, and what's neat is he's forced to. I want you to know this question is impossible to answer without actually going to the Bible. But there's something sneaky about what he did. He says, what is the greatest commandment in the law? Right? So what does he have to do? Tell them a commandment in the law. And he does. And he finally goes to Scripture. And what he says here is really sneaky. He throws in all this stuff, right? Love the Lord your God. The Lord, the Lord, the Lord. He takes the Bible not to point to the Bible. Yes. Think about it. He says it. He says, you know, what is the greatest commandment of the law? I don't know. Maybe if you keep these things, I'll bless you. Apart from these, I'll curse you. Write these on your hands. Teach them. Write them on your doorpost. Teach them to your children. Keep them before your eyes. There's a lot of good answers that would have been given there. Is the fact that he says, keep these things. Do these things. But he doesn't say that. He takes the Bible, and instead of using the Bible to point to the Bible, he uses a verse like that. He uses a verse that confronts our very, very weird idea. And our very, very weird idea is that the Bible somehow has replaced our need for God. Because you have three different gods offered here. You do. You have Caesar. And you have money, both of which are referred to as gods. And you get the same offering today. You can worship your country. You can worship money. You can worship those things that he confronted at first. And what did he say? Those belong to Caesar. Don't worry about those. We're worried about the things that belong to God. We're not worried about money. We're not obsessing about do we pay taxes or do we not pay taxes. He's saying we're focused on those things that belong to God, and what belongs to God is truly important. In the second question, it's this resurrection, and you have this option of worshiping the silence. The silence is saying, well, this is exactly what's written. I don't care about anything else. That's all I need. All I need is a collection of teachings. And the problem is, in the midst of it, what does Christ keep telling them? He's saying, you're reading this book, but you're not finding what it's pointing to. You're reading these stories. How many of you knew that when he says, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he's telling you about the resurrection? That's what Jesus said. He said, that's what's teaching you about the resurrection. And finally, he comes to a last story. And this story is this same elevation concept. This same elevation where not just we don't need God because we have a book, but instead of replacing God with the book, we elevate the book to God. It's called orthopraxy, orthodoxy. Great, crazy terms. It means this. Orthodoxy is you got it all right. You have your practices. You have your concepts. You have your ideas correct. Orthopraxy. How many of you ever heard that word? I had to look it up, Justin. It took me a lot of dictionaries before I found one that really had the word in it. Oxford Dictionary does, English doesn't. And I looked this word up, and you know what it means? Right practices. Well, nobody cares about that. Think about it. Orthodoxy is a common word, and it means right beliefs, and it is essential to have right beliefs. But there's a difference between having right beliefs that you don't live and having right beliefs that you live. Hi. I'm sorry, I get distracted. Y'all are supposed to be listening to her, but I was. That's kind of a perfect interruption. That's kind of what we're trying to talk about today. That little girl knows very little of the scripture, probably because she's this big. She knows maybe some stories. But she knows what those stories point to, right? We don't teach little children stories. We don't teach them stories so that we'll go, okay, you know that story, don't you? We don't teach them the story of Jonah so they'll go, oh, Jonah, let me tell you about Jonah. We teach them the story of Jonah so they'll know about the God behind Jonah. We don't teach them the story of David and Goliath so we'll go, I want to be like David, really, really small. Giant people are bad. We're not supposed to do that, are we? Is that the point of the story? I made up that point and it was true. David was short. He's a head shorter than Solomon, who is Saul. Who's then, what, two more heads shorter than Goliath? So, okay. And that's the point you're supposed to get, is short people are better than tall people. We're supposed to get that David had God on his side. Not that he was a short person. Not that he used a sling. Okay, so did the Benjaminites. Nobody said anything about them. The point was never for us to read that story, to read it as a story and go, okay, here's these little points. The point of the story was to point to God. And anytime we put anything on the throne of God, we've replaced him. And the tricky thing about the Bible is this. It's holy. So it's easy to make that, it's less of a step of making a person, the United States, money, those things into God because we know they're not even holy. But when we take the Bible, it's holy. So there's this temptation to elevate it to God. And if you've ever seen our churches, you would figure out what's really worshipped. Okay? Oh, we go to churches, and what's elevated? Sorry for using your daughter as an illustration. She was a perfect illustration. But what I want you to consider is, do you know why they came together? It says, and they came together on the first day of the week to do what? Some of y'all said break bread. I thought we were supposed to read the Bible. I thought the whole point we came here was because there was going to be a sermon. I'm just kidding. I don't think that much of it. Do not forsake fellowship together. It didn't say, do not forsake coming together so that you can hear a lovely sermon. So that you can hear the word of God read. No, don't forsake fellowship anymore. I didn't write that stuff, guys. And then he says, you come together to do what? Break bread. This is center. This is our focus. But how do we get everything perfect when we're focused on this? Why doesn't it say come together so you can read scripture? That's what we do. It says come together the first day of the week to break bread. Because center of divine worship is Christ. It's his body and his blood that's center. It's not words in scripture. It's not our culture that we come with. It's not our problems, our background, or the world around us we come to. It is Christ. And there are so many times when we think that if we believe all the right things, we know so much scripture that it's instantly going to translate and we're going to have this relationship with God. And it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work because Jesus pointed it out. Jesus pointed out that it wasn't working. You have people reading their Bibles. Sadducees read their Bibles better than any of us do. Sorry. None of us go home and write down scripture so that we make sure we know all of it. We go home and read it. That's excellent. And that's what we should be doing. But they tried to inscribe everything. The scribes, get the name? Scribes are writing it out. They know the word of God. And yet having the word of God, they're missing God. Having the very word of God, they can't figure out they're missing God. And yet, I'm going to tell you that somebody created five acts of worship, and if you don't have them, it doesn't count. Well, somebody else came up with this idea that if you come together to break bread, if you come together for the body and blood of Christ, I don't care if we didn't do anything. I don't care if we just showed up. That's all we did, and we left. To say that's not worship is probably to show you why we're so confused. Because we think that partaking of his body and his blood is not the center of our lives. And I'm sorry, our lives should revolve around that. Our lives should revolve around Christ. And we should do what he said to that first question. Give to God what belongs to him. Give to God what is God's. He made you. You belong to him. He makes those around you, they belong to him. He gave us Christ because he loved us. He gave us the church. And he told us to stay connected to that church. And a man with a Bible is not a church. I don't care what that man's name is. Stoner, Campbellite, I don't know. Whatever your name is, it doesn't matter, you're not a church. Because Christ's body is the church. Christ's family is the church. That's an awesome book that can guide us and point us in the right direction. We just can't stop and think it's the end of the world. We got to look at it and say, where's the Christ in that? If I read a passage on the burning bush, I better be looking for the resurrection of Christ. Because Jesus found it. And when I read scripture, I need to be looking for God. Today we have an invitation. That there is one body and one spirit. You are called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. That's what we're offered today. The one. The one Bible. But if you have a Bible and you're not part of that one body, you're not a member of it, you're not a member of Christ, then you miss the God for the book that points out. Today we have an invitation to believe in what he's taught us, that Jesus is Lord. To confess Jesus as Lord. To repent of our sins in light of his forgiveness. To be buried with Christ in baptism. To live our lives for Christ, always going back to his holy body that we are striving to be. We have that invitation that apart from, it doesn't matter what you know, believe, practice. If you're not in him, it's gone. Today we have an invitation of prayer. Because as we spoke of, Scripture tells us to confess our sins one to another. Apart from that, we're not practicing. And then we have the opportunity to submit to the eldership here. If anybody needs to respond to any of those, we ask you to come forward as we stand and as we sing.